Hi everyone, this is GKCS. We are going to be talking about combinatorial game theory today. So, the games that we are going to be focusing on are impartial games. So, you have games like chess or tic-tac-toe, and those games are partial, so they are more fun to play with in a way. Because you have, in chess, you have pieces which are specific to you, so you can't move your opponent's pieces. Similarly, in tic-tac-toe, you have symbols which are specific to yourself, so you can't use your opponent's symbol over here to make your own street. You can't, you know, use your opponent's symbol, of course. So this looks ridiculous, but that's what a partial game is. You can't use your anything specific to your opponent because all the game states have everything generic, right? The most common example of an impartial game, just write that down, is the game of Nim. So Nim has these piles of coins, and you have n piles of stones or coins or anything that you like, and you have to take out zero. No, zero is not allowed, in fact. So you have to take out one or equal to one coin from a specific pile. So you come across these piles, and let's say they have A1, A2, and A3 coins. And you choose a pile first, so let's say you choose A2. And then you can take out one or more than one coins from this pile. And the objective of the game is that you take away the last coin from all the piles. So, no, not exactly. Well, you take away all possibilities of your opponent is the objective of the game. So you have these three piles, and essentially you need to reach a state where two of the piles need to be zero. And one of the piles needs to be non-zero, so that you take away all the coins and give your opponent this state, in which they can make no moves and they lose. So that's the objective of the game of Nim. Alright, and the reason why I'm stressing on impartiality is because the theory that we're going to be talking about is very specific to only these impartial games. Alright, so let's start. The first operation we need to know about is called minimum excluded. So MEX is the short form for it, and it stands for minimum excluded. Alright, this is an operation that you need to perform on a set. So you have a set of numbers which are non-negative, and if you perform this operation on this set, you get a single number. You get the smallest number which does not exist in the set. So 0, 1 exist, those integers exist, and 2 does not. So this is the smallest number which does not exist in the set. Alright, and the reason why you might want to use this is because this tells you, S gives you the set of moves that you can play. MEX tells you the smallest move, the first move that you can never play. So that might be useful information to have, and so that's the operation that we'll keep in mind. And using this very operation, we can calculate something called Grundy numbers. So Grundy numbers are actually core to impartial games. So a Grundy number defines the entire game state. If you have a board, or if you have a pile of coins, n piles of coins with different coins in each one, a single Grundy number can define the entire game state, right? And every impartial game has this Grundy number. So the way to calculate it is, you take the minimum excluded of your set. If your set is empty, that's the base condition, then MEX of 0 is equal to 0, right? MEX of the null set, or we can define it as empty brackets. So MEX of the null set is 0. And MEX of anything else is equal to the way that we have defined above. You take the numbers, you take the next number which comes up, and that's what you give out. So MEX of S over here was 2. Alright? So let's just go through a quick example. You have this MEX operation that we know about, And Grundy is max of a set of moves that you can play. So let's say you have a pile of 10 coins, and the only kinds of moves that you can make is either take 1 or 2 or 3 coins. So these are the number of coins you can take. And the termination condition is, if you have no more coins to take, if you don't have any move possible, then you lose the game. So 0 is losing. Right? So you need to play optimally from 10 coins such that your opponent loses. So Grundy of 10 is what we are looking at. And that is defined by max of all possible states that you can have from this state. So you might think that this is 9, 8, and 7, because those are the positions that you can go to. But that won't define the game states. That would define just numbers. What you really need is game states. So this is incorrect. What we have instead is Grundy of 9, comma Grundy of 8, and Grundy of 7. So what you're seeing is that this function is recursive in nature. Grundy of 9 in turn will call 8, 7, and 6, and so on and so forth. So you know what, I'm just going to simplify this a little bit. I'm going to keep track. Grundy of 5, yeah. 5 seems to be good. And here we'll have then 5, 4, and 3. So let's pick the simplest, Grundy of 3. Which is max of Grundy of 2, Grundy of 1, and Grundy of 0. Alright, Grundy of 0, understand, is losing. So that is 0. You have no more moves to play when you have just 0 coins remaining. So this is 0. Alright. Grundy of 1, what could that be? Well, you could move to state 0. You have just one coin. In fact, you have just one choice. So if you have one coin, you have to take it, and then you move to this state which is losing for the other player. So 0 is in your set. The next number which is missing from your set is 1. So this is 1. Grundy of 2, on the other hand, if you have 2 coins, you can either go to 1 or you can go to 0. So you can either go to 1 or 0. This is your set. And that in turn, I mean, you can of course do Grundy over here also. Grundy of 0 is 0. Grundy of 1 is 1. But you don't need to actually, because these are the base conditions. So this max of this is equal to 2. So that's what G of 2 is. It's 2. Right, and we have Grundy of 3 giving us between 0, 1, and 2, we need to take the max. So max of this is 3. Grundy of 3 gives us 3. Let's replace that. 3. Similarly, Grundy of 4 is going to give us max of G of 3, G of 2, and G of 1. We know G of 1 is 1, G of 2 is 2, and G of 3 is 3. So they become 3, 2, and 1. Now, interestingly, it might seem like the max is now 4, but we have missed that integer 0. So the smallest number which does not exist in this set is 0 now. Great. So Grundy of 4 turns out to be surprisingly 0. And this makes logical sense, you know, because if you have 4 coins, there's nothing you can do apart from losing. If you take out 1 coin, you reach 3, your opponent takes out 3 coins. If you take out 2 coins are remaining, your opponent takes those. And if you take out all 3, there's just 1 coin remaining, and your opponent takes that out to put in the losing state. So you should be at 0, and that's what we have seen over here in the theory. Alright, Grundy of 5. gives us Grundy of 4, Grundy of 3, and Grundy of 2. We need to take the max of these three. So Grundy of 2 we know is equal to 2. Grundy of 3 is again equal to 3. And Grundy of 4, surprisingly, is 0. So 0, 3, and 2 are your numbers in the set. What we get from this is that 1 is missing because we are taking the max operation. So this turns out to be, Grundy of 5 turns out to be 1. Oh. Well, I think I have found out the Grundy of 5, is it here? Ah, well, we are in luck. We are going to be using 6 coins then. But you see how to calculate this, because Grundy of 6 now is equal to the max of 0, 1, and 3. So that is 2. So Grundy of 6 turns out to be 2. Alright, and this is just a basic theory. Using this, we are actually going to be solving named games. And this is just the basic theory about impartial games. I'm sorry there's no practical implementation yet, but that'll be very soon in the very next video. So hang on, it's coming soon.